Hello and welcome back. I'm Carley of Gnarly Carley Gaming, and today I'm going to be talking about two social deduction games that I think are amazing. I've already spent an entire video talking about how much I love Blood on the Clocktower and how I think it is the most elegant social deduction game I've ever played. However, similar to how you don't always have the means or desire for fine dining, sometimes other social deduction games I'd rather bring to my table. And so I'm going to talk today about two social deduction games that I think complement Blood on the Clocktower and anyone's collection, or may perhaps be a more feasible introduction into social deduction. I love Blood on the Clocktower, and I don't mean this video in any way to dismiss Blood on the Clocktower or suggest it should be different or change, but rather present these games that bring something different than Blood brings to the table as great recommendations for someone who's interested in Blood or loves Blood on the Clocktower. The first reason I want to give suggestions is that Blood on the Clocktower at minimum needs 6 people to play, including a storyteller who could run what they call a teensyville script. But even still, you're not really getting the full breadth of what Blood on the Clocktower has to offer, nor do you have access to even the main scripts at that player count. Another factor is time. With any new players involved or at large player counts, Blood on the Clocktower can just take a while. On average, as we've been bringing people in my group into the game, it can take like a good hour and a half to run a decent-sized game unless victory happens quicker than most. And not everyone wants to do that or jump into that, especially if they're new to social deductions. That can be a very overwhelming and lengthy experience. I am also known for playing Blood on the Clocktower, but I don't always have the mental capacity to do it. Whether on the good team or bad team, it is mentally exhausting. Like, you are constantly thinking of plays or trying to work out what's going on in the game and hunt down the demon. And even if you know what's going on because you're on the evil team spinning the tails, it's exhausting in a sense to keep up, especially over how long the game takes. And sometimes I just don't want that experience, even if I want something social deduction related. The last thing I wanted to address is the beginner friendliness of Blood on the Clocktower. While I do believe that a new player could be brought into the game and have a great time, I think that there's other social deduction games that are better equipped to bring people into the genre. I have family and friends alike that I think would either be too intimidated to jump into Blood on the Clocktower, or else at least just overwhelmed if they had to lie or to navigate all the rule sets for the first time. And not to say no matter what you do, you won't have that experience when you first play Blood on the Clocktower, but I think trying out other social deduction games, which can be phenomenal in their own right, can make that process an easier one. Or perhaps just let people find joy in the social deduction genre that don't want to play Blood on the Clocktower. The last thing that speaks to the beginner-friendly issue is also the price tag. While I think Blood on the Clocktower is completely worth the price for the materials you are given and the game that you receive, it's not accessible at the price that it is for everybody. So both the recommendations that I'm bringing in today are around the $25 mark. And I didn't choose them because they're cheap. They were the first two recommendations when I thought of social deduction that I wanted to talk about. And that being a factor is just an added bonus to speak to their accessibility. The first of the two games I wanted to recommend is Knight of the Ninja by Brotherwise. In Knight of the Ninja, players play as ninjas within rival ninja houses, either the Lotus or the Crane. At the beginning of the game, they receive a card that tells them which house they are part of and what their ranking is within that house. Their goal is to kill the high-ranked players of the other ninja house before the end of the round while helping to keep their own high-ranked ninjas alive. The problem is you don't know who's in your house and what their rankings are and who's in the opposing house and what their ranking are. So the whole round is spent trying to suss out information and eliminate rivals and hope at the end of it that your team ends up on top. The first thing that happens is a card draft. Every player will grab 3 cards. You will look at them, take one, and pass the other 2 to your left. Then the player on your right will pass you 2 more, you take one and discard the other. Everyone will then have 2 action cards with which they can use in the round to find out information and affect gameplay. This little token here represents your life, and usually after you die, you flip it over so everyone at the table knows who's still alive, but it also serves the dual purpose of highlighting the phases of the game. By phases of the game, it's just a fancy way of saying the order in which the cards we have get played. First, anyone with a spy card gets to look at another player's house card, seeing their allegiance and rank. Then, anyone with a mystic card gets to go, viewing the house card of another player and one of the cards they drafted. Tricksters follow and, unlike other cards in the game, perform a variety of actions, everything from revealing house cards, acquiring extra actions from those discarded, stealing points, and killing other players. Blind assassins then come on the scene, able to kill another player, followed at last by shinobis that are allowed to view a house card and then decide if they want to kill another player. And if multiple people are playing the same type of card, they resolve in turn order based on the number that is on their card from 1 to 6. And that's it. At the end of all of those phases, everyone reveals their cards, and whoever is alive and has the highest ranking at the table, their house wins that round. These rounds take all of 5 minutes, maybe a little longer if you're new, and then everyone who is in the winning house pulls from this little Knight of the Ninja bag and gets their little ninja star. These can be anything from 2 to 4 points, and essentially you keep playing rounds until one player has 10 points and wins the game. Them and them alone are the ninja victor. So classically in social deduction game, you have a good and an evil team. Usually the evil team is relatively small and has to lie and weasel their way to victory, and the good team is typically telling the truth unless they're doing so for a maneuver, has a squad of people to help them out, and are trying to figure out what the evil team is doing and stop them before they reach their objective. It can be really difficult to be a new person and be evil. I love being evil, don't get me wrong, but there's something nice about this game where you have an entire rival clan on your side, and it's also only 5 minutes long. It means even if it's your first game and you pick a stupid cards where you look at two things, but get the wrong people and don't feel like you know what you're doing with all that information, the round's over like that, and then you can try to do better the next time. Then you can realize, oh, maybe I should have withheld that I wasn't on the same team as someone. And oh, I could have taken this card, and then after I spied on someone, I could have actually killed them, and that would have been more useful. But that's only 5 minutes, and the game isn't over yet. That was just one round, and you have the next round to compensate for it. It makes it really beginner-friendly. It also means the mental load is just much less. Because if you don't want to do any of that, if you don't want to overthink it, you can still do relatively well. You can follow the phases, you can play alongside people. There's no trickery about when you should do something. Everything's laid out in a specific order. It is just a fine social deduction game that is just so, so, so accessible, even for people who've never gamed at all before, or perhaps are just getting their toes wet in social deduction. It's also just fucking fun. Knight of the Ninja can be played with anywhere from 4 to 11 players. It is low-key and great for a casual game night, and I think is the gateway game when it comes to social deduction. The second game I wanted to suggest is this right here. It is Bank Heist by Lonely Hero Games, which is one of my favorite social deduction games that isn't Blood on the Clocktower. It is highly underrated and oh so, so, so fun. As the title suggests, all players are members of a crew trying to commit a bank heist. They not only have to perform a successful robbery, though, they also have to make sure they can get away unscathed. Making it all the more complicated is there might be rival crew members as well as cops amongst us. So the first thing I have to show off in this game is the board. It is so thematic and such a central focus point of the game, and it is incredibly well done. In the center here, you have your getaway car, and this is where we're actually collectively trying to accumulate money bags that we're basically hurling from our bank heist and put them in our getaway car. Once it's full, and only once it's full, we can make our escape. During the robbery phase of the game, players draw a card and pass it to someone else. If it is a money bag and they are a crew member, they must put it in the getaway car. If they're a rival of that team, they can keep it to themselves. Or if they're an agent, they'll probably want to hold on with it, slowing down the robbery. If the robbery cannot happen fast enough, the crew and the rival crew don't get away with anything, and the agents win. However, not all cards are cash. There's things like zip ties and adrenaline and a bunch of different actions that can allow for players to kind of figure out what's going on with the group around them. Sometimes you'll be able to share your cards with other players, or show off that you do indeed have a crew tattoo. And a lot of it is trying to figure it out, because if you make your getaway, that's where player elimination and intensity begins. If and only if the robbery is successful, we move to the getaway phase, where people try to use the information and resources they've collected during the first phase of the game to eliminate their rivals once and for all within the getaway car, hurling towards the hideout. And this is what makes Bank Heist so unique to me. Unlike other social deduction games that are grounded in player elimination, in Blood on the Clock Tower, every day you want to execute and the demon kills at night, and in Night of the Ninja, everything is trying to eliminate your opponents. In this one, you still have to do that, but the whole first half of the game, there's not even a discussion of who is necessarily at the ready to be eliminated. It will all happen later. And it's just an information and resources exchange and intensity building to this ultimate moment that resolves rather quickly. So even if people suss you out right away, they still have to contend with you. They still have to talk to you. They still have to worry about you, and you can still get your way. You still probably want to lie if you're not a part of a crew at first, but there's so much more wiggle room and involvement throughout the whole game, even if you are the first elimination in the getaway car. Bank Heist is engaging and thematic and an amazing addition to any social deduction collection. It is one that I think is just a really cool shakeup from the traditional player elimination focus of a social deduction game. So while I did indeed throw away Secret Hitler at the end of my Blood on the Clock Tower video, and I stand by that action, it doesn't mean that I don't enjoy other social deduction games. Blood on the Clock Tower has my heart. It is so elegant and such a wonderful game, but there's room in my heart for more social deduction as well, and these games are just excellent to me at what they do. This is your very, very approachable gateway game that still has some meat and intrigue to it, and this is just another wonderful addition to the social deduction genre that is thematic as hell and so dang fun. And I love them, and I wanted to share them with you because I think both of them haven't received half the love that they deserve online. So from a Blood on the Clock Tower fangirl, Bank Heist and Night of the Ninja. Those are my recommendations.